can't see that clock. Like mine says 2:52, right?
Okay.
So I'd say you're probably going to start around 2:55. So that means, what, 3:45, right?
Okay. Yes, yeah, I don't, well, because I don't mind too much. I just want to.
Sorry?
I don't mind really too much. I just want to have some sense when I'm looking up there to kind of know where I am in the.
Yeah, I understand.
Yeah.
So you're not doing the slides?
No, there may have been a mistake, but.
I didn't realize. You're trying to motivate something, right? So.
Well,
it will probably be better if you.
I mean, I never normally give slide talks, but I've. But I didn't realize it would be such a deep auditorium. But I guess I have this big chalk.
Okay, so yeah, we should resume. Okay, thank you all for coming back. So we have a great pleasure of having for the second and concluding talk of this afternoon's session, Matthew Emerton, who will tell us about the p-adic Langlands program, motivations and
applications.
Applications, okay, super.
Well, thank you very much. It's a real pleasure and an honor to be speaking here. Actually, I met Peter in some incidental sense when I was a graduate student because I had a good friend who was a graduate student at the same time at Princeton. But I met him properly a bit later on in my career, one time when I came to Princeton to give a talk. And for some reason, for family reasons, he couldn't come to the dinner or even come to the cafe after the dinner. But around 10 o'clock at night, we could meet at his house. And so we did that, and we talked until 3 or 4 in the morning or something crazy about mathematics. It was very exciting. And it's always been exciting to be doing mathematics with, you know, with him around or talking to him about results or getting ideas about, you know, new pieces of mathematics to think about. So on the other hand, I mean, the mathematics that I kind of typically think about and the mathematics that Peter thinks about is sort of involve automorphic forms often, but maybe from slightly different approaches. But it turns out, I mean, somewhat to my surprise, that there's sort of some overlap in what can be done with different points of view. And so that's one thing I want to try and explain in this talk. So I want to begin with some motivation, and then that will somehow naturally drift into some sort of applications, I hope. So as an algebraic number theorist, we're interested in the Langlands program, but in particular, I'm interested in what I'll call reciprocity. And so reciprocity is supposed to be the connection between automorphic forms and Galois representations. And so I just, it might be good to just sort of remind you of a famous instance of this, which is the following. So if F is a modular form, so this is a modular form, but let's say it's a Hecker eigenform. It's weight k, level n, and some character epsilon. Then So because I'm a p-adic Langlands guy, so p for me has to be reserved as a special prime, and so a typical prime has to be L. So if we have a prime L not dividing n, we have an associated Hecker polynomial. So we have a polynomial, which is x squared minus ALX plus the character of L times L to the k minus 1. And so this is encoding the Hecke eigenvalues, the character, and the weight. And well, so there are different ways to think about this Hecke polynomial, but one way is that it's the characteristic polynomial of a semi-simple conjugacy class in GL2, as in the last talk. And we want to think of those semi-simple conjugacy classes as coming from Frobenius elements in Galois groups. But just before I write that, let me describe a more particular case, which is if E is an elliptic curve over Q of conductor N, then if L, again, is a prime not dividing N, then we have a quantity AL attached to E, which is essentially defined in the following way. So it's AL is defined so that the number of points on this elliptic curve defined over the finite field FL is equal to 1 minus AL plus L, which is x squared minus ALX plus L to the 2 minus 1 evaluated at x equals 1. And so that's sort of the first indication that Hecke polynomials, so local L factors on the automorphic side, have to do with local information on the Diophantine side. And so there's a now very famous theorem of Wiles, Taylor and Wiles and others to completely finish off the theorem, saying that given E, we can find an F of level N, weight 2, and our trivial epsilon, so that the AL for E goes to the AL for F. And that's the modularity theorem for elliptic curves. So so the theorem was and remains very exciting, but sometimes when theorems are proved, the theorem is proved and the subject is kind of finished. But in the case of algebraic number theory, when the theorem was proved, it was a fantastic, unbelievable theorem. Of course, the consequences are also pretty unbelievable. But the theorem itself was unbelievable, but at the same time, it initiated some wave of developments and investigation, which is still kind of continuing. And the p-adic-Langlands program grew out of trying to understand the methods that were used in proving modularity and how to kind of push them further. And so that's why I want to start with this theorem. So I don't want to talk in detail about how the theorem was proved, but I want to kind of make a few remarks. So one important point is that the proof proceeds via reconsideration of Galois representations. And so I want to say a little bit about that. So on the one hand, one has a construction of Deligne, which says that we have our F, our eigenform, and it's a complex valued function on the upper half plane with some properties. So all the quantities that appear here are complex numbers. But in fact, so F is actually defined over a number field. So in other words, well, the characters taking values in roots of unity. So these are certainly algebraic numbers. But these ALs are also necessarily algebraic integers. And this number field, well, it's a number field. So you can choose a prime above P, and you can think of it being embedded in QP bar. And then once you choose that embedding, Deligne constructs for you a representation from the absolute Galois group of Q into GL2 of QP bar with some properties. So this is the absolute Galois group of Q. So it's a rather big profinite group. And this representation will be unramified at primes that don't divide P, the special prime we chose, or N, where N is the level of F, just as before. And it has the property that the characteristic polynomial will be, to say that it's unramified at these primes L is just to say that it makes sense to talk about rho on the Frobenius at those primes. And then the characteristic polynomial is exactly equal to the Hecker polynomial. So we have that that Galois representation. And then on the other hand, if we have an elliptic curve E, well, E has a tape module. So it's an inverse limit over powers of P of the P torsion points. And so just because it's going to be, I'm going to take more inverse limits in a little bit later in the talk, so let me just remind you what this looks like. So the torsion points on this elliptic curve, I mean, as a complex curve, this is just a torus, C modulo a lattice. And so these torsion points just look like, well, if it was one circle, then they'd be cyclic, but it's a product of two circles, so it's a product of two cyclic groups. And so in the inverse limit, you get a product of two copies of the p-adic numbers. But of course, algebraically, these torsion points are, their x and y coordinates are algebraic numbers, and so there's a Galois action. And so we get an action of the Galois group on this. And if I want to kind of match with what I had on the other board, well then, this is a ZP squared. It's a ZP module of rank 2. But I could sort of tensor up if I wanted to with QP, just extend scalars to QP bar. And then I get a representation that I might call rho again. And now, so maybe here this is rho of F. Maybe here this could be rho of E. And then so the modularity of E is proved by working with the Galois representations, by kind of to say that your show rho equals rho F is a slight understatement of what happens, but you think this is the object you begin with. You sort of have this, and then you have a pile of these, and you want to show this one is kind of in the pile of things you have. So when you do this, there's a key feature of the situation. There's an absolutely key point, is that these representations, so into GL2 or into GLN, live in families. So that's an absolutely crucial point. And so the way you're supposed to think about it is you imagine for a moment this was just a finitely presented group. If this was a finitely presented group, then to give a representation, maybe it has seven generators, you have to give seven matrices. Maybe those generators have three relations. The matrices have to satisfy three equations. So there's an algebraic variety, the representation variety, that classifies these rows. Well, now this is now suppose this was a completion, some kind of profinite completion of that group. Well, then the entries of the matrix should satisfy some inequalities so that all the sequences that converge in that profinite completion converge. So that will mean that instead of having a variety with entries in QP bar, you have some kind of region inside that variety with inequalities that the entries satisfy. So there's a kind of p-adic rigid space. And one, that's not obvious, but one knows something about those spaces. For example, if you started with this row E, and you kind of looked at like what's the connected component of our Galois representation space that contains it, it's three-dimensional. It may not be as smooth as I'm drawing it. It could have singularities, but in any case, it's a, at least a priori. But so it's a, there's this sort of three-dimensional space, and your row E is one point. But now you think about your Fs. Well, even, we in fact expect the level, the weight to be two and the level to match. So in fact, there's a finite number of Fs. Even if you didn't, even if you were kind of less ambitious or less confident in conjectures and looked in other levels or other weights for the F, because you weren't confident you would find it in the right place, nevertheless, there's only countably many eigenforms. And so your row E is in this big three-dimensional box, and there's countably many points coming from modular forms in that box, and you're trying to show that your row E is sitting on one of those countably many points. That's a bit of a tricky thing to do, just kind of a priori. And so a kind of crucial tool that was developed, originally introduced by Mazur and then developed by Wiles and by Taylor and Wiles and Mark Kissen and many others, is to sort of know how to work inside this three-dimensional space. But you want to connect it to automorphic forms. So a thing that would be very nice would be if the automorphic form universe also had a three-dimensional box. Then at least you'll be comparing two things of the same dimension and trying to match them. And then perhaps later you could figure out inside those two three-dimensional worlds, the Galois one and the automorphic one, you could later try and think about whether a point in the automorphic one was coming from weight two and level five or some other thing. So the kind of issue you have in this sort of theory of modularity of Galois representations is that automorphic forms, as they're classically described and are, don't move in p-adic families, but they match with things that do, and that's a kind of big, fault on the part of automorphic forms. So one would like to correct it. And so that's sort of a big part of the goal of the p-adic Langlands program, is to find a way to extend the theory of automorphic forms from a p-adic optic. And so that's what I want to talk a bit about. So I'm not really going to talk more about automorphy theorems, or modularity theorems, but I want to sort of use them as a motivation to explain why it is that we would like to enlarge the space of automorphic forms. So. And so, so here's sort of one goal. So, different people can have different goals, but here's sort of one of them. My goal at the moment is to extend the notion of automorphic forms to allow p-adic variation. And so to do that, there are a lot of problems with this. So, one case you could think about is, the basic difficulty you're going to have to begin with is that automorphic forms, as they're defined, are complex valued functions on some locally symmetric space. So there's sort of nothing p-adic about them at all. And in fact, the only way they ever made contact with QP bar was some miracle that the coefficients were algebraic. For example, that's a miracle that's not known, like in some mass form cases where it should be true, like when lambda equals a quarter, it's not known. So it's really a miracle somehow. But it is known for kind of holomorphic modular forms, and we could try and remember why. So how do we know, how do you prove that? Well, there are several different ways. There's kind of the theory of modular equations, and there's a theory of the algebra-geometric theory of modular forms. But another kind of pretty convenient way is what's called the Eichler-Shimura isomorphism. So automorphic forms, at least, say, classical modular forms of weight 2 or higher, and you know, analogous in other higher rank groups, if you have automorphic forms of regular weight, they can be described as cohomology classes. So essentially, so automorphic forms, let's say, of regular weight, can be described as certain cohomology classes. And so essentially, one could describe this as Hodge theory. So if you were looking at really a co-compact lattice in some higher rank group, then it really just would be Hodge theory applied to the compact quotient of the symmetric space by the co-compact lattice. If we were looking at classical modular curves, which are not compact but have pretty simple cusps, then at least number theorists call this, algebraic number theorists call this Eichler-Shimura theory. And then in the general non-co-compact case, I guess it's due to Franke, who kind of made a pretty profound generalization of Hodge theory in these non-co-compact cases. But in any case, it's something that we know. So we can use cohomology to describe automorphic forms. And cohomology has a big advantage. For example, how does cohomology let you show that Hecker eigenvalues are algebraic numbers? Well, because the cohomology, you could take Z coefficients, and the Hecker correspondences will preserve the homology or cohomology with Z coefficients, and so the eigenvalues will be algebraic integers. So if we want to do something p-adic, we can do ZP coefficients. So we'll do that, but still, it's not enough just to kind of take ZP coefficients in cohomology because, if you have maybe you're looking at modular forms of weight 2 and level gamma naught 11. The modular curve's an elliptic curve. There's a one-dimensional space of cusp forms. The cohomology of that elliptic curve is a two-dimensional vector space. Well, you could make it a two-dimensional ZP module instead by taking ZP coefficients, but it's still just a two-dimensional ZP module. It still just has one eigenspace for the Hecker operators. So it doesn't kind of give you, you don't suddenly miraculously by changing a letter in the notation for your cohomology, make a space suddenly become three-dimensional instead of zero-dimensional. But so one thing you can think about though is that what in this box where this rho E was moving, so we were looking at representations that were unramified outside P and N. So ramification away from P, you can't really just move around and suddenly acquire ramification or lose ramification away from P if you did or didn't have it to begin with. Ramification away from P is a pretty rigid thing. The reason being that the wild inertia group at a prime L is a pro L group, and QP bar is pretty close to a pro P group. And so the wild inertia can't interact very much with this thing, and so wild inertia can't turn on or turn itself off as you're moving around in a family. But wild inertia at P is a pro-P group, and that can change like crazy as you move around. And so in particular, if we fix this N, and we're looking at what's happening at P, any modular form with any power of P in the level, like suppose you chose this N to already have P in the level, then those modular forms will also contribute points in this box, because they'll still give you Galois representations unramified away from N and P. So we can essentially, if we have some level in mind and we add any power of P to the level, the modular forms you get are kind of lying in the same part of Galois deformation space. And so if we're trying to kind of look for this family in cohomology, it sort of makes sense to look for modular forms of all P power levels and kind of build them into our construction, because we know we don't expect to find them. And so that's what we're going to do. And so we will so we'll have g of r. So I don't want to spend too much time writing down all the kind of notation that comes into, you know, as soon as you start writing down holomorphic forms, you can just spend your 50 minutes writing notation. So I don't want to do that. So G is some semi-simple group, and I take the real points, and then I can take a symmetric space. So this could be SL2R. This will be SL2R mod SO2, which is the upper half plane. I have gamma, which is a congruent subgroup, say SL2Z. And then I can look at not just gamma, but as I said, I want to now look at all the congruent subgroups of gamma for all powers of P. And then I want to look at, so if we're doing SL2 modular curves, or in general the locally symmetric spaces of these levels P to the R. So I have X mod gamma at the bottom. I have X mod gamma P, X mod gamma P squared, X mod gamma P to the R. So I have a tower of locally symmetric spaces of increasing P power level. And I can do two things, and it's kind of convenient to do both, even though it's a little kind of irritating when you're not used to it. So I can, I want to say, look at the homology up this tower. So I could look at homology at level P to the R, and as I said, with ZP coefficients. And then I want to package it all together. Well, they're just maps. I just take an inverse limit over R, and I'll call that HI tilde. So a lot of this theory I'm going to explain is joint with Francois Caligari. And so we call this a completed homology for gamma. And it's an interesting thing. So we see that we're seeing all levels. But we've taken this inverse limit. So this inverse limit is sort of a completion process. So even if we put in all p power levels in here, we still get just a countable set of points. But then you want to, you have q is inside r as a countable set of points. If you complete it, it becomes all of r, and it becomes a nice continuum. So the idea is you have this countable collection of points in here coming from the modular forms of all p power level. And you'd like to kind of imagine that you somehow complete them out, and you get the whole thing. Well, so this inverse limit just does that. So, in a simple case of, say, modular curves, each of these will be a ZP module of some finite rank. And this inverse limit, just as a ZP module, would end up looking like not a direct sum of copies of ZP, but a product of copies of ZP. So this thing looks like a kind of a product of copies of ZP, or something of that nature. But it's more than a ZP module. It has a lot more structure. So it has acting on it let me put TL in quotes, because in higher ranks, I'll have more Heck operators for each prime. But for each prime, not dividing P or the level of the congruent subgroup gamma, I have a kind of Hecker operators acting. And altogether, they generate a kind of big algebra of endomorphisms. So it's a little bit like a kind of von Neumann algebra or something like this, acting on, you think of this as maybe like a p-adic Banach space or something like that. And this is kind of like some kind of von Neumann algebra of operators acting. So here, really, we should take a kind of weak closure. So this T is a kind of a completed thing. And in fact, this T will be the ring of functions on the automorphic version of this box. So the automorphic version of this box is going to be the spec of this T. So this T is very important. But I'm not going to dwell too much on it in the rest of the talk, because it's the thing that's most, sort of the thing that's most connected to Galois representations. But there are other features that are also kind of interesting and novel and a bit easier to explain in one talk. So, what other structure do we have? Well, we have the at, you know, here, we have a deck transformation group, which is basically the z mod p to the r points of our group acting as deck transformations. So at level p to the r, we have the z mod p to the r points, like SL2 z mod p to the r, or SLN z mod p to the r, acting here. But then if you go to the next stage, to the next stage in the projective limit, well, you have a bigger group acting. It's now g of z mod p to the r plus 1, and then g of z mod p to the r plus 2. So there's a natural object that just acts on the limit. So there's a what sometimes called lambda, because this is some traditional notation in Iwasawa theory. So it's, you just take the projective limit of the rings that are acting at each stage. So at each stage, you have an action of this group ring. And so in the projective limit of these group rings acts, which is sometimes people write it this way. As a kind of suggestive way to write it. Because so this isn't what you're going to get from a semi-simple group, but just imagine for a moment we were allowed to do ZP. Yes, thank you. This is just G of ZP, yes. So suppose we just took ZP, then this is isomorphic actually to a power series ring over ZP. And so if this was an abelian group, if G was an abelian Lie group of dimension D, this would be ZP, a joined D power series variable. Now this G is some semi-simple group, it's not abelian, but it's, say it's dimension D. This will look like some sort of twisted power series ring in D variables. The D variables won't commute, but it'll be a bit like an enveloping algebra. It'll have a filtration so that it's commutative modulo the filtration, and it will have a lot of properties that that enveloping algebras have, or power series rings have. So these were studied by Lazard. And so one thing he showed is that this lambda is an Noetherian ring, for example. So, okay. Oops. So we have this lambda that acts. So we have this Hecker, we have this lambda. The actions commute, the lambda and the T actions commute because they're kind of coming from different primes. In fact, the whole p-adic group acts on this HI tilde because he took out all the p-power level. And so again, that's, so we have this kind of, The ZP points act, actually the QP points act, the ZP points act through this lambda, so this lambda acting is a little more than just saying G of ZP acts. It's sort of some statement about the continuity of the G of ZP action, but packaged in a very precise and convenient way. So this G of QP action is also very important, but it's in a way an analog at P of this action away from P, but I'm not going to dwell on it in the rest of the talk. So in the rest of the talk, I'm mainly going to focus on this lambda action. So I'd just like to show you one example in this case. So it's an example. If you take a tower of circles, does each circle covering the next by the degree P map? Then you have a Z mod P at each stage, and in the whole tower you have exactly a ZP. So the kind of whole, tower is kind of a ZP. And you could compute the H naught tilde, And that would just be, there'll be a ZP in each knot at each stage, and they just, the transition maps to the identity. And then you could look at the H1 tilde. And now the transition maps and fundamental classes are multiplication by P. And so you have basically the intersection in ZPs of everything divisible infinitely by P, or the set of elements in ZP that are infinitely divisible by P. So that's zero. So that might look a little nerve-wracking, actually, because you've basically killed off all that was interesting topologically about these circles. And so you could worry that, in general, in this process, we've kind of, by taking this limit, we've actually killed off all the automorphic forms. And instead of kind of making our space that we wanted bigger, we maybe have made it sort of empty or something. That wouldn't be so good. But in fact, it doesn't happen. So you can always recover the homology at any finite level by out of this completed cohomology. So there's some spectral sequence, but I feel like I don't know if I'm gonna be the first person to write a spectral sequence down in this conference. So what I'll say is that kind of roughly the homology at finite level is equal to this is kind of roughly equal to the cohomology. The gamma p to the r co-invariance in the homology at infinite level. So if you like to write it algebraically, that would be taking the group ring at finite level, tensioning over the group ring at infinite level with our module, which is at infinite level. But it's roughly. So they're correction terms. I mean, we see it can't be exact because, I mean, zero, even if you don't know how to compute a tensor product, you can guess that zero tensor anything will be zero. So I guess my daughter says now, like she comes downstairs and says, Dad, 350 zillion, quazillion, dillion, billion, million times zero is zero. And so, yeah, this is zero. So there's correction terms from some higher tors. So there's a tensor, there's some higher tors that give correction terms. But those correction terms, they're truly correction terms, as in a sense that we'll see in a little bit. In particular, in this case, what's happening is that I already told you that the group ring in this case was this power series ring. But this ZP is not free over a power series ring. It's a torsion module of the power series ring. So when you go to finite level, the fundamental class of the circle at finite level comes from a tor. So the H naught actually knows about the H1 at finite level because it's torsion over the lambda. So somehow in this theory, the information that was kind of purely topological at each finite level in this limit is split between topology and the algebra of lambda and this module over lambda. And so you can kind of, so you see already from this example of the circles that this module can kind of be an interesting lambda module, and that can kind of have information. And one difficulty we have in the theory of automorphic forms, especially in higher rank groups, basically beyond modular curves, is it's not so easy to compute cohomology of locally symmetric spaces. So if you can encode somehow you see that you have some mechanism that encodes the topology in more algebraic terms, you could hope to exploit that to kind of do something. So that's what I want to explain. But I want to also explain another point. Because those people here who know Eichel-Shamurian theory and so on will know that if I'm looking at just the cohomology of modular curve or level p to the r with constant coefficients, I'm not seeing all the classical modular forms that way. I only ever see modular forms of weight 2. Or this could be a congruent subgroup in SL2 of Z adjoint I. And then the X will be hyperbolic 3 space, and I'll be doing hyperbolic 3 manifolds. But again, here I'd be seeing, if I took H1, I'd be seeing cohomology classes that corresponded, again, to modular forms on that Bianchi group, but of parallel weight 2, not of higher weight. But you also, if you know that, then you also know how to kind of correct for it. You have to get higher weight forms, you should choose a representation of gamma or of G. So if W is a G rep, so then WC, the Z point, sort of the, I mean, W is something like, you know, this case symmetric power of the standard representation or something. So you can just take the sort of Z part of it, and that's a gamma rep. So it gives local systems, coefficient systems on each quotient. And then, again, roughly, the homology on, let me even say, in particular on X mod gamma, let me just do it for gamma, the bottom level. So then the cohomology on X mod gamma with coefficients in W, you know, in this local system, is we get it by, is roughly equal to, well, we have our infinite level thing. So now, well, if you think about how you compute this, maybe I want to kind of make it over ZP, so I still have kind of ZP coefficients, but twisted ZP coefficients. Then, well, I could, you know, if I'm working over ZP, I could work mod P to the N, and then, or P to the R, and then let the R go to infinity. But if I work mod P to the R, and I go up to level gamma P to the R, the congruent subgroup at level P to the R acts trivially on any representation once I've reduced that representation mod P to the R. So when I go up the tower, I can just pull this out. But then I want it to be back down at level 1, so I better glue it back in. So I tensor over this lambda. So that's a convenient formula. And again, they're higher torque reactions. So what I want to finish by explaining is just one thing you can do with this package, which sort of wasn't an initial goal for Frank Rui when we were sort of thinking about this kind of stuff, but turned out to be interesting. So first let me show you the case of G is all SL2 Q. So the real point is SL2 R. The X is the upper half plane. Modular curve, just, I mean, literally, this quotient is an open modular curve. So then you can compute this H1 tilde. It's not quite free over this lambda, but it's extremely close. So this H1 tilde will sit inside some free lambda module, and the quotient will be, let me just get it straight. There'll be something like this. Some exact sequence like this. So if this ZP was 0, and this was surjective, you could split this off and just have lambda to the n minus 1. This H1 tilde will be lambda to the n minus 1. But it's not quite lambda to the n minus 1. It's kind of slightly off from being free over lambda just because of this ZP. And this ZP is kind of the zeroth H0, the H0 tilde in degree 0. But ZP is pretty small from the point of view of this lambda, because now we're doing SL2. So this lambda is like a twisted power series ring in three variables. And your ZP is a twisted power series ring in no variables. So it's a pretty small deviation from being free. So this thing is essentially free. And so we can just presume that it is. And so we see that, I'm sorry? Yes, it's just a map to H naught. This is kind of a complex, it's computing the H1 and the H naught. Maybe it's just convenient to put plus one up there, so I don't have to put minus one now. So we kind of, this H1 tilde equals ZP to the N, equals lambda to the N. And so we see that the H1 at level gamma P to the R we get that by just replacing this lambda by the group ring at finite level. And there are no tors, if it's free. And H1 is in W. Well, then we just tensor this lambda with W. So we just get W to the N. And so what do we see? Well, we see, for example, that in the weight aspect, the number of modular forms in the weight aspect goes like this. N is some fixed thing, but number of modular forms in the weight aspect goes like the dimension. The dimension, the rank over ZP of this module is just the size of this SL2 Z mod P to the R, the size of the covering group. That's the volume, the co-volume of the lattice. So we see that the number of modular forms in the level aspect is going like the co-volume. So of course, those are well-known concepts and kind of things of interest in the analytic theory of automorphic forms related to limit multiplicity formulas and so on. And we see they're kind of encapsulated in a simple algebraic statement about this H1 tilde. And so just let me finish by stating, so I wanted to state two theorems, so one that Frank Caligari and I proved, and then one that Simon Marshall proved. So if our real group does not admit discrete series, Hi tilde is torsion over lambda. So a key feature of SL2R is it admits discrete series, and that's what's driving this growth. But if conversely, if the group doesn't emit discrete series, Hi tilde is torsion over lambda. And that has an interesting corollary. So there's a power saving in the growth of the cohomology as you go up the congruence tower. That it grows, so it's different to this situation, which was the case when we were a free module. When you're not a free module, you really get growth in the co-volume. You get a power saving in the growth of the cohomology. And hence, if you turn back into automorphic forms, in the growth of the automorphic forms. So this, the sort of proof of these two theorems, these results are kind of closely linked. But what's the idea? So the point is that we exploit the algebraic structure. See, we see that if our HI is free over lambda, or essentially free over lambda, has a non-trivial free part, then we really get growth that goes like the covolume. On the other hand, because this lambda is algebraic, and as I said, it's essentially a power series ring, if you have a torsion module, then the growth is really has a power saving, just like it would if it was a commutative power series ring. So that was worked out by Michael Harris. So there's sort of a dichotomy. You either get growth like the covolume, or you get a power saving. But then the work of DeGeorge Wallach and then Savin shows that when you don't have discrete series, they show that you always grow like little o of the volume. So that's a kind of analytic argument. So some analysis gives you little o of the volume, and then this kind of algebraic description of the situation comes in to give you the power saving. And it's almost out of time, but I would like to just state the result of Simon Marshall's in the same spirit. So Simon, he's a student of Peter's, who did many things, actually, but one of the things he did was look at the question in the context of this theorem of what happens if you investigate the weight aspect. And so here's a theorem of Marshall, another good Southern Hemisphere bloke. So he showed that. If G equals S or 2, F, where F is not totally real, then the dimension of HIW goes like, or sort of bounded by dim W again to the 1 minus epsilon. So we got a power saving in the ring. But the way he did it was he used this formula. He used so our theorem says that this HI tilde is torsion over lambda. So then you want to prove that. So Michael Harris's results, which we used to get the corollary, show you that when this is torsion, you can kind of recognize that by reducing to the finite group quotients of lambda. But now you want to kind of recognize that torsionness by testing against the different algebraic representations, which is a little, right, sort of the definition of lambda was naturally involving the finite quotients. So it's not so hard to think that you could kind of connect lambda to the structure under the finite quotients. When you're tensoring with these algebraic representations, the algebra becomes trickier, sort of quite intricate, but he was able to do that and prove this result. It's an excellent result. So one appealing thing about this result is the prime P doesn't get mentioned, for example. But nevertheless, the proof entirely goes to this p-adic theory. So I think my time is up, so I'll stop there. But happy birthday, Peter.
Oh, thank you so much. Questions for Emerton?
I have a comment.
This is a beautiful theorem, and one reason that it's so striking to me anyway is that it applies to tempered representations, because if you can analytically get the power saving if you're non-tempered, as you know. So that's what's... to actually give an upper bound in the tempered range, this is the only way we know. Nothing else is known as far as...
So that result that you had on the board on the right, it reminds me of with Iwasawa's theorem, you have this growth formula for class numbers in a tower, and then after that he has Iwasawa's conjecture, the main conjecture that was proven, and there are some generalizations, some that have been proven. Is there an analog of the Iwasawa main conjecture for HI hat?
Yes, there is. So one question which is closely related to that is, so because this lambda is a pretty nice string, it's non-commutative, it doesn't quite have a spec. So modules you can't quite localize them over lambda. But nevertheless, there's a sense in which there's a precise sense in which you can talk about the dimension of support. Being torsion, which is what we show, is the same as having a positive, the support has positive codimension.
Okay.
But what we believe is that in fact, this is a conjecture, that the codimension of the support should exactly be the famous quantity L naught. So there's a defect from having discrete series.
Is L naught related to a p-adic L function? Or?
No, I mean, there's a To have discrete series, you should, Karsh-Trandis tells you, you should have a compact Cartan. So you can look at the maximal compact, you can look at the most compact Cartan you can find and see how many non-compact factors it has, even though you tried to get rid of them. That's called L-naught. So L-naught is zero when you have discrete series, and L-naught's positive. So this theorem says that the codimension of support of HI tilde is positive exactly when L-naught is positive. But in fact, much more precise should be true, that they should be equal. And that will be closely related to showing that the spectral theory on this gadget has the correct dimension of the box I was drawing before. So it's an important question, but it seems to be difficult. But just because you've given me the chance, I'll say one other thing, which is that, say in the case of quadratic imaginary fields, we show this as torsion, that includes possibly being p-torsion, and we don't know that the p-torsion thing isn't free over lambda mod p. But the question I asked in the problem session is equivalent to showing that the p-torsion was equivalent to showing this as p-torsion free, actually. Even though at finite levels there will be an incredible amount of p-torsion in the limit, they've all turned into ZPs. And that will be like an analog of the vanishing of the mu invariant. So I think the question of the vanishing of mu invariants is, of course, it's a very interesting question and important in Ewers power theory, but the analogous question here is very important too.
Thank you.
Thank you. We could take one more question. Any? Okay. But if not, then the tea is set up outside so we can continue over there. Thank you, Matthew, again. And tomorrow.